We have a panel with a broad geographical distribution, a little bit more narrow with respect to the fact that we have one medical oncologist and four head and neck surgeons.
Not that I feel outnumbered.
Dr. Dana Farber is from Dr. Worthy from Dana Farber in Boston, Dr. Wei from Queen Mary's Hospital in Hong Kong, Dr. Samant from Memphis, Tennessee, Dr. Bradley from Nottingham in United Kingdom, and myself from Lund in Sweden. And we have the four surgeons to the right, and our medical oncologist to the left. We have discussed email in email during the last week a few issues that we would like to raise. And from this very basic science, we actually would like to focus on one very simple thing, and that is staging. Because as we have heard before today, it's the staging that usually is the main base for our selection of patients and decisions on treatment. And I know that Dr. Bradley have thought about this.
Have my slide. Can I have my slide, please? I think staging is the key, and I think Dr. Wirth has alluded to this. I think we, up until 1997, we really didn't have a uniformity of staging until the Hong Kong whole staging system was amalgamated with the UICC, and the whole lot was bettered in that John Ho did a clinical staging, which was really from clinical experience and exposure, and he was the one, I think, that alluded to neck masses and size, volume of disease, yet he didn't have a CT. So when the UICC AJC in the sixth edition in 1997 brought in the CT scan, so it could then evaluate the primary site. So by amalgamating the two, I think we've got to be circumspect with the pre-1997 series that we have in the literature, which I suppose for current is historical. I think unless we actually can amalgamate the staging system uniformity across the countries, I think we're going to be talking about chickens and eggs, et cetera, et cetera. And I suppose working in the National Health Service in Britain, a bit like Hong Kong still has its British National Health Service. That is, all patients can get CT, MR, PET scans, and everything for free. So I think this is a, not anymore he shakes, but he used to. I think this is a unique area of where you have a homogeneous group of people with probably the same EBV, WHO type 2, type 3 cancers, as distinct from which Dr. Wirth is, the American type series has got up to 25% of patients who have got keratinizing squamous cell carcinomas. From my point of view, I think the EB virus, it's a bit like a pregnancy test. It's not necessarily positive or negative. You've got degrees of positivity, and one wonders whether you should actually be able to titrate your patient on a staging system as to how positive they are to determine their outcome, because I think immunotherapy seems to be an ideal platform in which we should be able to experiment with these patients. I think tumor volume is being discussed now that we have CT and MRI. I think MRI is suggesting that some of our stage 3, stage 4 diseases are overstaged, and that maybe we've got an element of stage migration. I think we're limited with our treatment modalities, that is radiation, chemotherapy, and surgery for salvage, that is surgery at the primary site, and surgery for the metastasis. But I think immunotherapy, antiviral studies, etc., may be of interest. But I think in the end, this disease among the Western societies, to me, is a hodgepodge of different diseases put together. And I think because of economic reasons, out in Asia, we won't get our patients staged EB virus, et cetera, which makes looking at these patients from an economic point of view a very interesting group of patients, but I think we're going to be longer in investigating these over the years. So in essence, my message is that staging has been higgledy-piggledy until 1997, and I think it's only reporting series after that, and I think we need to be more precise about the type of patients that we're investigating and reporting. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Comment of the day?
Before I comment on Dr. Bradley's staging, I think Dr. Laurie has been mentioning about the immunotherapy with Epstein-Barr virus. We have actually, we will start a project with the Queensland, this Queensland Institute of Medical research has already has an agreement with us to start this immunotherapy with Epstein-Barr virus specific T cells. The patients are already being recruited. It's a phase two trial, and the money has already been gathered. And the only thing is some logistics with the Australian government. Once it started, we will start this phase two trial. And hopefully, in a few years' time, we'll tell you whether this thing works. We test it in the rats, in the rats, and it works beautifully. But once they come to humans, sometimes the results may be different. We don't know. But that's on in the pipeline. As for staging, yes, the nasopharyngeal cancer staging actually initially is for surgeons. So, you know, whether the lymph nodes are fixed, the large size, whether tumor involves subsites. But nasopharyngeal cancer basically is a disease treated by radiation and chemotherapy now. So whether the subsites, the T subsites in the T or the nasopharynx doesn't really matter because they just enlarge the field to cover the nasopharynx. Also the laterality of the lymph node doesn't really matter because again, as long as the nodes are high up in the neck, they just enlarge the field, covers it. Nodes that extends further down the neck, they further just enlarge. So the size, so the lymph node stagings are a little bit different from the other head and neck cancers. Yeah. So that's forms the basis of this staging. And now in the 1997 staging, this all has been taken into consideration. T1 means everything is inside the nasopharynx. The subsite doesn't have a rating on the T staging. So since 1997, we have better staging. So the report results will be better, comparable subsequently.
I would also ask a question to the panel. Dr. Bradley had a set PT in the staging. The panel, we can have CT, MR, and set PT. Is set PT standard, should be standard, or is it extra when you stage your patient?
PET scan.
Well, I noticed, Dr. Bradley, you had it on your slide and you didn't mention it.
No.
You know, I think...
It still is in investigation, I would think, in that not every place has it. Maybe right. US, you have a divine right to have a PET scan, whether you need it or not. But I think in the UK, PET scanning is very much rationed, mainly because of cost. And I'm sure in Asia, it's much the same.
PET scan is not a routine for all patients. MR or CT is the routine. But PET scan, the patient has to pay. There's no national health supporting the PET scan. Patients to pay. Some patients can pay, some patients can't pay. So it's not prerequisite for treatment, but MR and CTs are.
I would hate to have to pay for my PET scan. However, they can be quite useful. You know, there is one series that has shown that that PET scans are useful in nasopharynx cancer and that there is a small percentage of patients who are upstaged. And because of the greater frequency of distant metastatic disease at the time of presentation, those patients can be picked up and importantly spared of the significant toxicity that they would have with very aggressive concurrent chemoradiotherapy for local regional control, which is going to become less of an issue if there's distant metastatic disease. So we do tend to do PETs partly as the divine right of the patients that we're treating. But I think that there can be some clinical utility in them. And then the other thing about PETs is that they are helpful in the workup of patients with unknown primary tumors. And we do see our fair share of patients who initially present with unknown primaries who may have even had an endoscopic exam, either an office fibroptic exam or an exam under anesthesia, and had a nasopharynx primary missed that then is seen on the PET scan. And we go back and do a tissue diagnosis to confirm that. But they can be helpful in that regard as well.
Yeah, PET scan, certainly, I know there are the questions about its availability in many parts of the world, but where it is available, it's pretty accurate. In fact, it's been shown to be more accurate than MRI. And its benefit may be really in situations where particularly with advanced tumors, MRI is doubtful, and you can then selectively use PET scanning to help answer the question whether or not this is a true negative or possibly a persistence of disease.
I can see a problem, and that is if some centers use PET scan and others don't, you can get upgrading with the PET scan, and thus you get a stage migration, and then you have a selection of patients going in clinical studies and other studies. So it's very important to give a report on how you actually have staged the patient. So I think we can come back to the issue of the PET scan. When we prepared this panel, we discussed also about the not of quality of life. We discussed that 2 years ago here. But the problem is the patients that actually recur, and how we can follow disease control and failure patterns. And I think Dr. Smant has some ideas about
that. You can put my slides up, but I guess much of that has been covered by Dr. Wirth already. So the first thing I would like to point out is that if you look at these two studies from Hong Kong, first by from Queen Elizabeth Hospital, and 13 years later from in the nasopharyngeal study group in Hong Kong, there is a 25% improvement in survival. So it's safe to say that there is significant improvement in survival in the last two decades. And the reason might be manifold. One is that there is the improved ability to use better diagnostic modalities. For example, in the second study, there was a subset of patients who had been staged by MR, and the outcome in that subset of patients compared to the rest of the study group was significantly better. The other, of course, is the ability to use better radiation techniques, better understanding about fractionation, the maximally tolerated doses, and ability to deliver doses in a conformal fashion, avoiding injury to the adjacent optic structures. And of course, improvements in salvage surgery, and Dr. Wei will talk about that, have contributed to the outcome. And chemotherapy, of course, has been shown, and this has been covered quite extensively, so I won't go into it. But the meta-analysis has shown that the MAC and PC meta-analysis, for instance, has shown that the benefit is really with chemotherapy when it is given concurrently, and there is not really any benefit when the chemotherapy is used either before or after chemotherapy. Also, you need to know that the failure patterns are such that still about 38% of the patients will get distant metastases, and there is quite a significant incidence of local regional failure as well. So that's an important thing to keep in mind. And although chemo did improve the likelihood of freedom from both of these types of failures in these trials. Also important to remember that chemotherapy is more useful for the so-called Western type of, or the keratinizing variety of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. But even when the type 1 cancers were removed from the analysis, the benefit of chemotherapy was still maintained. So the chemotherapy, when added to radiation therapy, is beneficial even for the nasopharyngeal carcinoma of the endemic regions. So there is level one evidence to support the use of chemotherapy. The benefit is modest. It's only 6% survival benefit at 5 years, 10% event-free survival benefit at 5 years. Benefit of chemotherapy is only seen when this is used concurrently. And although it is more effective for type 1 tumors, the benefit is still present with type 2 and type 3 tumors. And really, chemotherapy does reduce the likelihood of local as well as distant failure, but they continue to be a significant problem. So going forward, chemotherapy has to be, our approach, treatment approach has to target towards the possibility of reducing reducing systemic metastases.
Thank you. This poses another question. If we have a change in failure pattern induced by new therapeutic strategies, do we have to change our way to monitor or follow up?
I think that there are lots of interesting studies, and Laurie can talk about this as well, about the utility of quantitative PCR testing for EBV DNA, and that's been shown to be a very reliable marker for development of recurrent or metastatic disease, and even for finding out which of the 20% of the patients will have persistence of cancer after chemo radiation. So identifying that subset of patients who might benefit from additional therapy such as boost radiation or adjuvant chemotherapy. So EBV measurements may be helpful. in that regard.
I have a slide.